Congrats on the book. This might be a little on the nose because the name of the book is No One Can Pronounce My Name.
Yeah.
How did I do?
You did a great job.
Okay.
I have to say, it's been funny with this book title because I did an event in Boston. And I went up to a bookseller and I said, hi, I'm here to sign copies of my book. And he said, what's the title? And I said, No One Can Pronounce My Name. And he said, I'm sorry to hear that. So,
and this is your second book.
Yes.
So what was the length of time it took you to write this one? Because often you hear the second is the harder.
Yes. You know, the first one I had a very good idea of what I wanted to happen in the book. It was like 2 or 3 years I wrote it. This took like 5 to 6 years, and it's just because I'm lazy.
Okay.
Like, you just get lazy. You just think, oh, I'll finish it eventually, and then it just took way too long.
Well, it's interesting because your day job, so to speak, is you are an editor. So you talk to writers all day, and you give them advice on how to finish their books. Is there any advice that you give to other writers that you then take yourself?
No. I should say, I tell my writers all the time, be really regimented, have a schedule, write every day. I don't do any of that. I just feel like I'll take the laziness I don't have in that editing job and impart it to my writing life.
There you go. So this is a story. It takes place in Cleveland, a sort of 2 40-year-old immigrants and their friendship. And what I thought was really lovely about it is there is a real... I feel like when we hear immigrant stories, certainly right now, we hear the depressing part of it, and we're told that side of the story. This is a very funny, uplifting book about people who are... certainly have challenges living in America, but are very happy and feel very lucky to be here. Was that important to you to have this lightness to it?
Oh, very much so. I was thinking about, like, the terms we use to describe, like, quote-unquote ethnic or quote-unquote Indian American literature. And you're right. Oftentimes, there's something really sad that happens, and that's, like, the default emotion. And I think, like, in daily life, regardless of who you are, even if you're going through trauma, life is full of so much comedy and levity, and that's usually actually what you go back to save yourself. So it's very much the idea, you know, I think we make sweeping generalizations, or people can make sweeping generalizations about groups of people or immigrants and ethnic groups. And the truth is, personal stories is how our lives change. You know, like, that's the beauty of fiction. You know, you tell a story, you tell a really specific story, and it has a way of connecting with people, and they can continue telling that story to other people.
So grew up in Cincinnati, is that right? Mm-hmm. Were you born there?
I was born there, born and raised.
Gotcha. Yeah. So, and so your parents were they moved to Cincinnati?
They did, yes.
And so are they excited that you have this life as an artist? Is this...
Yeah, my parents have been really supportive of all of us. You know, my twin brother, Vikas, a fraternal twin brother, who is a marketing executive at Heineken. My older brother, Rajiv Satyal, is a stand-up comic. And then my parents, Vinay and Lalitha, they actually run a local radio program every weekend in Cincinnati, Ohio, on WAIF 88.3 FM. And it's called Bollywood Music and Masala.
Okay.
So, which will be my drag name, I think.
And now, you know, it's always, I think, lovely to see what people who are new to this country are drawn to. And is it true that your mother is a huge fan of Barbies?
Oh, yeah. So my mother loves Barbie dolls. She thinks they're, like, amazing pieces of Americana. And when my next-door neighbor actually had a Barbies of the World collection when I was growing up and added an Indian Barbie, I thought my mom's head was going to, like, pop off because it was, like, East meets West in this crazy culture clash. So my dad, meanwhile, is, like, not the world's greatest gift giver. Like, he once gave my mom for their anniversary 3 years in a row a pot to cook in. So every summer when I was in high school, I'd do this big regional youth theater in Middletown, Ohio, summer youth theater. And I was waiting for my friends because they would come. We would drive an hour to rehearsal, rehearse for 4 hours, and come back really late at night. So I'm waiting in the foyer one day, and my dad goes, Rakesh, come upstairs, 1 second. And I think, oh, God, the anniversary is coming up. Like, what could this be? So I go upstairs. My dad is leaning on a very large, hot pink Mattel box containing what is known as a my-size Barbie doll.
Okay.
So the idea is that little girls can play with Barbie and then take her dress and hair and wear them as their own, even though Barbie is now, like, naked and bald on the ground. And this was Rapunzel edition. So it had, like, a gold lamé and pink chiffon gown with a big braid. So my dad looks at me and he's like, fix that up, you're artistic, which is basically Indian code for you're gay and I don't know yet. So I'm, like, froofing the skirts in this thing. He gives it to my mother, who has the reaction that most people would have, which is, oh, it's great, you know? And my dad, like, puts it under his arm like he's Darren McGavin in A Christmas Story, you know, with a leg lamp.
Yep, yep.
Yeah, so my dad goes upstairs, come home a few nights later from rehearsal. Everything's quiet in the house, let myself in the side door, and there's this weird light coming from the back of the house. So I walk around the corner, and I scream, because my dad has bought a fitted curio cabinet for the Barbie doll with a pedestal with a light behind it like this.
Oh, my God.
It's still there.
It's still there. Well, yes. I have proof it's still there, because here's your mom very proudly holding your book with the Barbie lurking in the background.
There it is. Yeah. You can melt it down and give one to every child in Calcutta.
Well, she seems very proud. Congrats on the book. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Rakesh Satyal.